The Allen Lund Company appreciates all of the dedicated carriers it takes to move loads across the U.S. Stay safe.
OOIDA, representing America's truckers since 1973, presents Landline Now with your host, Mark Reddick.
The OOIDA Foundation's monthly market report shows a freight market still trying to shake off everything weighing it down. But if you look very closely, Andrew King of the Foundation notes a few positive signs. With the advent of LEDs, you can do all kinds of things with lights that were never possible before. I'll discuss the ins, outs, ups, and downs of LED lighting with Bryan Martin of the Chrome Shop Mafia. And finally, the annual road check is coming up soon, and that means truckers have just a short time to get ready for what they may encounter that week. I'll find out what you need to do to prep from Aaron Lynch and Tom Crowley of OOIDA's Compliance Department. But first, the news with Scott Thompson.
Thanks, Mark. Our top story today: the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration's Advisory Committee on Underwrite Protection was back at it this week, with members spending a good deal of time discussing the research that's led us to a possible mandate of side underrides. In NHTSA's 2023 Advance Notice of Proposed Rulemaking, or NPRM, the agency provided cost-benefit analysis which estimated that a mandate would save about 17 lives and prevent 69 injuries annually, while costing as much as $1.2 billion each year. Eric Hine, whose son Riley died from injuries sustained in a 2015 truck crash, delivered a presentation to the committee that questioned NHTSA's numbers.
The ANPRM was a fatally flawed example of government rulemaking. Its conclusion is grievously wrong, excluding 90% of preventable underwrite deaths. NHTSA should withdraw the 2023 Side Impact Guard ANPRM. Recommendation 2, NHTSA should complete a new Side Impact Guard cost-benefit analysis and rulemaking that counts previously omitted underwrite victim categories, including pedestrians, bicyclists, and motorcyclists.
Committee members Marianne Karth and Jennifer Tierney also criticized NHTSA's notice for not including the number of pedestrians and bicyclists killed in underwrite crashes. Tierney issued a motion for the committee to ask NHTSA to withdraw the advance notice of proposed rulemaking and redo its cost-benefit analysis. Despite concerns that withdrawing the notice would slow down the rulemaking process, the committee passed the motion with 7 yes votes, 6 no votes, and 3 abstentions. Meanwhile, Aaron Kiefer, a committee member representing motor vehicle crash investigators, later introduced motions to recommend that NHTSA require all new semi-trailers and all semi-trailers manufactured after 1998 to be equipped with side underride guards. OIDA board member Doug Smith, a committee member representing truck drivers, noted that the cost to retrofit some of the older trailers would be more than the value of that trailer. He pointed out that many of those older trailers are primarily used for storage.
The cost of putting that retrofit is much more than in new construction and new manufacturing, probably double. And so for the fleet of trailers in this country that gets out on the road once in a while, storage trailers, you're going to make them retrofit that for the greater than the value of the trailer for any trailer that's in the last 20 years old that's not in regular service, but you're going to make them all in violation at a tremendous cost.
Jeff Bennett, a committee member representing motor vehicle engineers, questioned the effectiveness of side underride guards.
If you crash into anywhere but dead center of the guard, it's not effective. I even saw some recent footage provided to us from a test that the Stop Underwrites group did, 45 degree crash, 45 miles an hour, which equates to about 31 mile an hour impact, perpendicular to the guard. Just basically the whole guard just sheared off and there was complete underwrite.
Despite the concerns raised, both motions passed. The advisory committee's next meeting is scheduled for May 22nd. The committee has requested an extension to the charter and to have another meeting in June, but those requests have not yet been accepted. Following the final meeting, the committee will be tasked with drafting a recommendation report to NHTSA. Due to a significant divide between committee members, there also will be a dissenting report issued to the agency. A motion was passed to give the minority committee members at least a week to respond to the majority report. The Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration shined a light on newly licensed drivers during the agency's annual safety research forum on Thursday. FMCSA said data show a troubling trend of new drivers and deadly crashes. Over a six-year period, FMCSA engineer Kelly Stowe said the percentage of fatal large truck and bus crashes involving new entrant carriers climbed from 4.6% in 2017 to 7.4% in 2022. That's across the backdrop of FMCSA's new entrant safety assurance program, an 18-month program that tracks the crash rates of new carriers. And the numbers show that the motor carriers operating within 24 months of graduating from the new entrant program had two times more total crashes and nearly double the amount of deadly crashes than established carriers.
So even after completing the new entrant program, which includes passing the safety audit, newer carriers are still getting in crashes at a higher frequency than more established carriers. If we can educate these carriers early on and make sure they understand the requirements and the expectations before they begin operations, we can prevent some of these crashes from occurring.
One solution proposed by Stowe, establishing a written proficiency exam for new entrants, something that was mandated by Congress in 2012 but has never taken hold. Making that happen is a work in progress.
I will say that currently, the fall 2023 Unified Agenda for Regulatory and Deregulatory Actions states that we will be publishing a second advance notice of proposed rulemaking in July of this year. But we do anticipate that that timeline will likely slip and be pushed out a bit in the spring 2024 Unified Agenda. Again, this is a very high-level work plan, and it is subject to change.
Stowe believes that could make a difference, pointing to two separate studies that compared companies that require such training with those who don't.
The driver out-of-service rate was lower for trained new entrants compared to the control group. Trained new entrants remained in business substantially longer than the control group, with just 6.5% going inactive within 600 days of entry into the industry, compared to 22.5% of the control group. So that's a much better retention rate, you know, for staying in business.
For now, officially at least, FMCSA plans to publish an advance notice of proposed rulemaking regarding new entrants in July, unless, of course, that gets pushed back, as Stowe alluded to. The amount of freight hauled by trucks across U.S. borders saw its largest increase in a year in February. According to the latest numbers from the Bureau of Transportation Statistics, truck freight valued at more than $83 billion was hauled across the borders in February. That's up 5% from January and up 10% compared to February of 2023. February's year-to-year increase was the largest since January of 2013, when cross-border freight went up by nearly 13%. Truck freight across North America has been trending upward for more than 3 years, with only two decreases since November of 2020. Cross-border freight hauled by trucks across the U.S. northern border rose by more than 8% compared to a year earlier in February. Over that same time span, the value of freight hauled across the southern border increased by more than 11%. An Iowa truck driver who went missing in November has been found dead. Authorities in Iowa say they found the body of 53-year-old David Schultz this week in a field less than 2 miles from where his truck had been left. The Sac County Sheriff's Office says he was identified by his boots. Schultz's remains have been sent to the medical examiner for an autopsy. Authorities haven't provided much else by way of details, such as whether they suspect foul play. Schultz, a livestock hauler, was last seen in late November in the Sac City, Iowa area. His loaded truck left abandoned, along with his wallet and cell phone. And finally, Vermont is turning to barriers to keep heavy trucks out of a notorious stretch of Route 107 known as Smuggler's Notch. Every year, several trucks get stuck on the road despite a number of signs warning them to turn around. So the Vermont Agency of Transportation is going to try out traffic barriers known as chicanes. They're designed to stop tractor trailers and other oversized vehicles from entering, forcing them to turn around. The chicanes, consisting of orange barrels and curbs, will be temporary and installed by mid-May. Officials say they'll monitor how effective the system is for 1 or 2 years, and if it works, officials say they might look to make them permanent. That's Lane Line Now News for today. I'm Scott Thompson.
Thanks, Scott. Next, we'll get the lowdown on the past month's freight market from Andrew King of the OOIDA Foundation. We'll be back in just a moment with more of the show. I'm Mark Redding, and this is Landline Now.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to like and subscribe. If you want more content, go to landline.media to get updated news, information, and archived editions of our show. Once again, that's landline.media.
Penske owns and operates some of the best-maintained vehicles on the planet. Our used trucks come with a 5-year maintenance report and pre-sale inspection. So if you're in the market for a top-quality pre-owned truck, look no further. Search our inventory today at PenskeUsedTrucks.com.
Control your toll costs and eliminate tolling headaches with PrePass Tolls. PrePass Tolls means toll volume discounts. Just one invoice for all tolls and fewer violations. Call 877-878-5970 or go to PrePass.com.
Ready to make more money? Use a better load board. For a limited time, get 50% off Truckstop Load Board Pro. Just go to truckstop.com/go and enter promo code READY2024 when you purchase Load Board Pro.
Welcome back. So here we are, 4 months into 2024, still looking forward to the freight market turnaround we've been told is coming. Are we getting glimpses of that bounce back, or are we going to be left holding the bag for even longer? Joining us with some insight, fresh off putting together a new monthly market report, is Andrew King, Assistant Director of the OOIDA Foundation. Andrew, good to see you.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Always good to have you here. I'm seeing data out there that suggests we are maybe, possibly, perhaps starting to see some signs of life here. Not a whole lot of life, but some. Yeah,
yes.
Like you said, there are signs of life on the spot market. I'm going to make you kind of summarize this entire March 2024 market update here off the top. What is it telling us, basically, on what you're seeing out there right now?
There are some positive signs. Yes, as you mentioned, there is some uptick in manufacturing activity, so that has boosted volumes just a little bit, but then basically everything else is not looking so great for the most part. Even though there was an uptick, and we'll talk about it with the load-to-truck ratio, there's a little uptick in demand, but rates are still falling. They keep finding a new floor. It seems like all the time we're just bouncing along the bottom, hoping that at some point things turn upward. But I would think that kind of sums it up in a nutshell. Capacity is still very loose. There are too many trucks on the road for the amount of demand that is going on out there. And it's not necessarily that demand is tanking. It's that demand has fallen to a degree where we still have this surplus of trucks.
Right.
And that is not helping anyone out there.
Yeah. I mean, looking at the data from others out there, you know, Truck Stop, DAT, ACT Research, I think, others as well.
Yes.
Are kind of pointing to this, right? That volume,
yes,
and demand are both up. Again, not a lot.
In a sense.
Explain that. What do you mean by that?
Well, there's certain industries or sectors that are still performing well, like motor vehicles, for example, or chemical manufacturing. And there's some degrees of wholesaling that is getting a little bit better. And inventories are getting basically to that pre-pandemic level. But there really isn't anything to push up a little bit further. So if you look at truck tonnage index that Michigan State University puts out, we're still down like 2% year over year as far as truck ton miles. And they look at 41 different indexes from wholesaling and from manufacturing, which are your largest generators of freight. So there is some maintaining, right? It's not falling off a cliff, like some might say, but it's not high enough to really help the rates at the moment. And so hopefully things will tick upward. There were some positive signs in March on the load-to-truck ratios, but rates are still down, as I mentioned. But here in April, I've been following along, and it seems like they haven't really improved that much. And this is usually when things start to pick up a bit,
yeah,
because we're entering into that spring season. But things have been muted, especially for reefers. And so that's just hurting. It's still hurting out there. Not that some people aren't being successful. In fact, I've talked,
sure,
to some of our members who have got a very niche market. They know exactly what they want to haul. They have the right lane. They have the right freight. They keep doing that. They've been doing it for years. And they've been pretty much protected from a lot of what's going on. But those who are living off of the load boards or off of brokers, they're definitely struggling.
Yeah, it's been a tough several months in that regard. And as you said, we're kind of waiting for the rates to pick up here. But again, and I'm not trying to be too, you know, Pollyannish or too optimistic here, but I think One thing that we can sort of hang our hat on here is that those entities I mentioned earlier, the CAS shipment index, they're also cautiously optimistic, right?
Yes.
That we are seeing some stabilization here, that we are going to be heading in the right direction. Again, there's not much lower we can go, I guess.
Well, I hope not.
Yeah, that's true.
But yeah, there is some uptick, especially if you look at the CAS truckload line haul index. And, you know, here's the thing. This is why you need to look at different data points, because if you look only at DAT or only truck stop or CAS or what have you, they all tell you just a little bit different. And what's pooled within their data is different. And the mix of contract and spot is different. So CAS has millions of dollars that they're covering. And many companies, and they do have spot and contract, but it's primarily going to be contract. And contract rates, even though they dip up and down a little bit, they've stayed fairly steady. But they are seeing an uptick over the last couple quarters. It's slow, and this is the thing to always remember, and this is something that we've been preaching here, is that when the market does shift, it's going to be very, very slow, unless there's some crazy event that happens, which is totally possible.
We all live through 2020.
Exactly. We know. Yeah. That sort of thing could happen again, or something equally as catastrophic that could really change the way things go. But I would not expect it to be a very fast climb.
I want to, and that's been your message again for months,
yes.
And it's held true. I mean,
because you mentioned other people have stated that in the first quarter or second quarter of this year, things would be turned around, and we have on this show have always said, no, that's actually not true. And this is important because you don't want to make a business decision on false information.
Yeah.
Especially if it's where people are saying it's going to turn, but it's not, and you're getting in or you're expanding and you find out it's not going to work out for you. Yeah, we want to be as real as possible, but we also don't want to be super depressing. So,
yeah, well, let's be pragmatic and realistic. And
yeah,
this is where we are right now, you know, if we're being honest, and we always try to be.
Yes.
I want to look at the individual types here, van, reefer, flatbed. And we don't have to get into the weeds too much on what we're seeing necessarily. But are you seeing signs, perhaps, that one is maybe poised to break through before the others? Any signs there? Or is this kind of an all-or-nothing proposition?
No, a flatbed is actually performing very well, and it's kind of having people scratch their heads a little bit, you know, because it's van and reefer are definitely up and down. And it's kind of interesting looking at the year-over-year, like, load-to-truck ratio and stuff. I mean, you'll have several months of year-over-year decline, and then every once in a while now you'll have one pop up that's actually positive. So that's kind of a good sign that things are starting to turn just a little bit. But when you look at flatbed, yes, that definitely stands out above the rest. Now, it still has had like 24 straight months of year-over-year declines in load-to-truck ratio. That's not a positive thing. But the rates are performing fairly well. The spot market increased another 2 cents in March. To $2.50. And contract rates also increased, but they increased by 4 cents. So, you know, the thing that we always talk about is the spread between the two.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, that spread just keeps getting bigger. I don't understand. and we definitely need to see something there change. But flatbed is performing fairly well. And some of that might be because the housing market is doing okay.
Yep.
It did have a kind of a down month in March, but February it performed very well.
Yep.
And so it just seems to be up and down.
And you mentioned this earlier, but the manufacturing numbers are encouraging.
Yes.
That, as we've talked about before many times, I'm sure, you know, this thing over here happens, it's going to affect this thing over there, which will affect this thing. It's all connected. They're all interconnected, and we're pulling strings. And the fact that manufacturing is relatively strong, I think we can say. I think that's pretty safe to say, right?
Yeah, it's doing better, yes, absolutely, especially when you exclude certain sectors that have a disproportionate impact. You know, they have a lot of money, but they don't actually produce a lot of freight. So when you exclude some of those and you look at more of like core freight factors, yes, it is trending positive, and that is a good sign.
Cautious optimism, I guess that's where we'll try to be here over the coming months. But at some point, we keep saying this, at some point, you and I are going to sit down and we're gonna be very happy with what we see.
Yes. Hopefully by the end of May, there'll be something that happens. If not, then it might be another year of just flat
All right. Let's not think about that yet.
Yeah.
In the context of this greater conversation, I want to get your take on a Wall Street Journal story that came out recently. I know it generated quite a bit of conversation within OOIDA's headquarters. This story kind of honed in on the capacity issue, or really the overcapacity of the market.
Yes.
Kind of argued that once some of this capacity does exit the market, rates are going to rise again. I know from these conversations that I've been kind of privy to, you take issue with some parts of this story,
yes,
at least. I won't put words in your mouth. I'll kind of let you talk about what they were trying to say or what they're saying, and maybe the issues that you have with it.
Yeah, I mean, I agreed with most of what the article was sharing, but just some, and maybe just me being kind of in the data and understanding it a little bit differently than perhaps others do, is that capacity is not a cause. So you're talking about cause and effect.
Mm-hmm.
So capacity going up or down does not change demand. It's the other way around. And so when people say, and in fact, this is something that I used to say too, until I've come to a greater understanding, is that we need more capacity to leave, and then that will cause the rates to go up. While that is not necessarily true, it could help maybe stabilize the rates a little bit, but it's what you need is demand to go up.
Right.
Because that is the biggest factor. That's the biggest cause. When demand goes up like it did in 2020, 2021, then supply tried to catch up.
Right.
Because rates were just crazy. There was so much loads out there, just freight needing to be moved. And there was a very, you know, normally the contract to spot is like, 85-15, right? But it went up as high, spot went up as high as like 25-30%. And that's why rates just went so, so high, right? But now things are coming down off that peak. But we had this supply that was trying to catch up to demand, and now demand is going below it. And now we just have all these trucks still on the road, and probably because of record profits.
Yeah.
So some of the large carriers are still able to maintain some of their relationships and what have you. But we really need to see demand go up. We still, and I'm not disagreeing that we need some capacity to leave,
right?
But it's not the cause that we're looking for that will turn the market. No market has ever shifted simply because,
yeah,
capacity increased or decreased.
Right.
It's always an effect, not a cause.
Right. Action, reaction. Yeah,
exactly.
That makes sense. This is also interesting too in the context of the, you know, this narrative, false narrative of a driver,
exactly,
shortage.
Yes.
So when you look at this story and you look at the way they're kind of framing it, it makes you even realize in a more clear way there is no driver shortage.
Absolutely. Not that there can't be at times, but a long-term driver shortage, there has never been one.
Yeah.
Never.
Yeah.
And for this very reason, I mean, just look at the rates over the past 20 years, and they go up and down.
Right.
If there was a driver shortage, that would never happen. It would either be steady or it would always be going up because you need to raise rates to attract labor.
Right.
And that is not happening. And so just like we talked about, when demand goes up, and you can see this, and we even have charts showing this very clearly, when demand goes up, then the number of truckers entering the industry goes up and rates go up because they're following one another. So demand goes up, I need more drivers.
Yeah.
If I need more drivers, I got to pay them more.
Yep.
And then the opposite is also true. So it just blows my mind sometimes that academic people and even legislators and regulators will still talk about a driver shortage. There is no way there's a driver shortage.
Yeah. Well, it's certainly a case of where you want something to be true, or you at least want people to think that that thing is true. So you connect things that are not related to it.
And if you say it long enough.
Well, that's exactly what's happened over the course of the past several years, is that it has been repeated enough and people hear it and they think it's reality. Exactly. Andrew, we'll have to leave it there. Wish we could talk to you longer, but I'm sure we'll see you again soon in the coming weeks. And, hopefully with better news.
Yes.
But we appreciate your analysis as always.
Thank you.
That was Andrew King of the OOIDA Foundation. Landline Now continues right after this. Please do stick around.
Are you tired of the IRS following you around like a dark cloud? Call 888-557-4020 and get your life back.
Firestone tires are for more of everything. With more durability for more miles and more confidence in your fleet, Firestone's tested tires help fleets save with value where it matters most. Find your local Firestone dealer today at firestonetire.com/dealer.
When it's time to overhaul your truck engine, help protect it by insisting on a genuine Vibratech TVD crankshaft damper. Heavy duty, absolute premium quality, and they're made right here in the USA. Find a dealer at VibratechTVD.com. It's tested and proven. Burn 2.1% less fuel when you balance all wheel ends with Centromatic. Call 800-523-8473 to get the OOIDA discount.
Landline Now. Thanks for joining us today. I'm your host, Mark Reddick. It's time for another installment of Mafia Secrets, Advice from the Boss Man, with Bryan Martin of Four State Trucks, home of the Chrome Shop Mafia. And once again, I'm on the line with Bryan Martin of the Chrome Shop Mafia in Joplin, Missouri. Bryan, how the heck you doing?
Man, I'm doing pretty good. How's things going up north?
Things are going real well. Very well, in fact. Thank you.
Awesome.
Well, let's talk a little bit about LED lights. And it seems like a few years ago, probably more than I'm willing to let on, these were pretty new technology, but it seems like now I see them everywhere. Why is it LED lights have grown so much in popularity?
Well, you said it. They are quite the norm now. And if somebody carries in an old incandescent light bulb to our counter, it's a very, very rare thing these days, as just everything, automotive, agriculture, trucking, trailer, heavy equipment, everything is LED lighting these days, and you can't blame them. I mean, low amp draw, it's easy on your electronics, it's easy on your circuitry, easy on your batteries and alternator. They last for many, many years. I would say the life expectancy of an LED versus incandescent is 50 to 1. I'm just guessing there, but you know, the things just don't fail very often, and when they do, it's usually 3, 4, 5, 6 years after they were put into service. And there's just really a ton of upside to them. You know, they got a brilliant light that you can't help but see, whereas a lot of the incandescents, as they go year after year, they get less bright, they get dull and chalky and faded. So just a ton of upside to go in with the light-emitting diode. We don't even remember what it stands for, but the LED lighting is just, it's a no-brainer. It probably costs more nowadays to manufacture an incandescent because they're producing millions of LED bulbs to tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands, if you will, of the old incandescent bulbs.
Well, I know for a while, early on in the LED revolution, some truckers who run especially in colder climates or winter weather were having a problem. The old incandescent bulbs used to melt the snow and ice right off the light color covers so that those lights were still visible to other drivers and the headlights still functioned. But you mentioned the lower heat of LEDs, and snow and ice were covering some of them up early on. To what extent have they solved that? What's the situation now?
Well, you're right. For 20 years, like your northern climates, they were kind of adverse to the LEDs for just that reason. Whether it was the taillights on your trailer or the headlights on your truck, if you went to LED, they didn't have enough heat generation to keep like the sleet, snow, and ice melted off of them. And, you know, a lot of people just stuck with incandescents, or you kind of lived with it and hoped for the best and got out and brushed your headlights off every so many hundred miles when weather warranted it. But now, I'm going to say of the last 5, 6, 7 years, heated LEDs, clear down to your marker lights, to your tail lights, to your work lights, like on your headache rack, you know, facing backwards, just your pure white work lights, and your headlights now are largely almost every size and style. Several manufacturers offer those in a heated version. Now, if you stay in Texas and Florida and Alabama and New Mexico, you may or may not need heated LEDs, but the rest of us, pretty handy thing to have. There's still a significant price difference. I can't tell you, hey, for a few bucks more, you can get heated LEDs. But the difference between heated and traditional LEDs, it's not an enormous price spread. They are truly affordable now.
Are you losing some of the advantage of lower power use when you have a heated light, or is it still advantageous over the incandescents?
It's my hunch that it would still be less amp draw than your traditional old transistor, you know, solid state type of halogen incandescent, especially when it comes to a headlight, I would think. But I don't think the amp draw of adding a heated LED is really a negative effect in any way.
I'm going to date myself a little bit here. You dated yourself knowing what LED stood for. And I still remember when one of the big deal advances years back was when they finally developed an actual white LED light, which enabled headlights. Which was not a thing at first.
And backup lights. You know, everybody had all LED taillights across the back of their truck or trailer. And then for years, we still had to use, remember the aircraft landing lights, like the big halogen with the thick glass. And I mean, those suckers were bright, but you better not grab a hold of the face of the white aircraft light or the wiring going into the back of it, because that sucker was hot. I mean, a big amp draw there. And white LEDs kind of revolutionized all of that from the front of the truck to the back.
Now, I know that at first these were only available in certain shapes and sizes for certain models and so on. Are they able to offer all the different shapes necessary for older trucks or for someone who just wants a retro look?
Yes. First of all, man, LEDs this day and age, whether you're getting them at a chrome shop like us or a truck stop or a dealership or an auto parts store, there are LEDs for every shape, size, and application. Of course, now you can get them with a clear lens, and then when you hit the light, it turns red or amber or whatever the case may be. That is commonplace. And then as of the last 4, 5, 6 years, you can even get your retro vintage-looking lights in LED. So for instance, like the old glass watermelon, remember the light fixtures, the bullet cab lights on top of the cab, or the old lollipop glass lens turn signal that were out there on the front fender. A lot of guys put them on each end of the bumper for a turn signal. You can even get brand new state-of-the-art LEDs that have that vintage retro lens. So you get that old watermelon glass effect. But in fact, it's got a sealed LED light base inside the glass, so to say, or the retro lens that's impervious to water and vibration. And it has all the upsides that you did not have with the old incandescents. I mean, vibration really doesn't affect them. Water doesn't really affect them. They're just kind of a well-engineered type product for sure. But yes, you can get them now in the vintage look. Every shape and size. I tell you what's kind of taken us by storm the last 3 or 4 years. You see them a lot alongside the air cleaners or all the way down the side of the sleeper, underneath the sleeper and cab, is just your little, a lot of people call them quarter lights because they're about the size of a quarter, or button lights, or even they've kind of slang as a 3/4 inch light, because you can shove one of these LEDs in any 3/4 inch hole. And they either push in or some of them are threaded and have a jam nut. But these button lights, quarter lights, we are selling them literally hundreds a day because they're so handy. You drill a hole, run your wiring to them, you're done. They're so versatile. You can use them inside the cab, under the dash, in the bunk, outside of the truck, down the side of the trailer. But those button lights are really really the trend right now in a lot of ways for accent lighting.
Now, a moment ago, you mentioned upsides, and we have been talking mainly about upsides on these, but I know that there are some downsides, and one of them that I've heard about is people saying that these LED headlights are bright enough that they create problems for other drivers, especially oncoming drivers, kind of blind them or make it hard to see. To what extent are you hearing about things like that? Is this another thing of the past, or is this still going on, or is it LED headlights?
Well, I don't know that it's anything that's maybe isolated to LED lights. If you've ever driven with a set of halogen bulbs, like let's just say, 98 model Freightliner Classic, you know, you got four 4x6 square halogen bulbs out there on the end of the hood. If you change those to projection lights or LEDs, the drivability and just your vision that it enhances, it's amazing. Like the light is so much more brilliant and genuine. I don't even have the right words here, but it's no pun intended. It's night and day between halogen. Like, you'll feel like you got a new truck if you upgrade it from halogen, those of the few that still have them, to LED or projection headlights. But I don't know. When I don't have a lot of customers complaining that they're meeting trucks with LED headlights and it's aggravating them. You know, I think any of us could jump in any vehicle, and you go down a two-lane road and you meet somebody in a brand new Super Duty Ford pickup that's got his brights on. Man, it's aggravating. You get a lot of these custom headlights that kind of got that blue tone. You know, does it hurt your eyes? No, but it is aggravating to me. And maybe I stand alone on this fact, but I don't think it's isolated to LEDs being super bright and aggravating the other drivers on the highway. I don't hear a lot of that complaining. I hear much more satisfaction about, wow, I wish I'd have bought LED headlights 5 years ago. You know, I get a lot more positive comments about LED headlights than I ever do negative about meeting them in oncoming traffic.
Let's talk about something really cool here. We've got about 3 minutes left. Years back, Grody Lights, I think it was uh-huh. offering this cool innovation they called Light Form. It consisted of strips of varying lengths that looked like clear plastic but had tiny little LEDs embedded in them. And it looks like maybe that was an experiment that didn't get to the market. But there is flexible LED strip lighting that's out there that appears to be outdoor rated. I mean, it seems to me like the applications for that would be endless.
Yes, we still sell a lot of strip LEDs like you're talking about, whether it's, you know, 6 inches long, 12, 18, 36 inches long, 48 inches long. We sell a lot of those strip lights where you just connect two power, you know, a power and a ground, and it lights up the entire strip. A long-lasting, hassle-free, a lot of uses for that. But to your point, they're also not, you can buy that in a roll where it's encased in rubber, it's flexible. For a large part of applications, you can literally double face tape them on. Now, I wouldn't want to do that, you know, on the bottom side of your trailer or something like that. You'd want to use some fasteners to hold it down securely. But, you know, they're multi-purpose. If you're putting them on your golf cart, in your sleeper, on your pontoon boat, double face tape may be absolutely fine to mount it with. But the strip lights when they first came out, really cheesy. And that's a decade plus ago. But now you can buy them at a parts store. You can buy them on the internet. You can buy them from Amazon. And they really are kind of the cat's meow. You can find so many uses for those things. And they're in all different colors. It's not just limited to red, amber, or white. You can get them in almost every color, including pink.
Well, you can get them that can change color, can't you?
Oh, you definitely can. Yeah, they've came just such a long ways.
Well, Bryan, we just got about a minute left. And I just wanted to ask about one other thing here, and that is I've been reading about how you can automate these things to do different motion effects. And I'm curious, are you seeing a lot of show trucks try kind of creative stuff like that?
I personally haven't seen it yet. A lot of them you can just change by dialing it in. But as far as a fully automated color changing, it seems like to me, from what I've been exposed to, that's a little bit more of the automotive car pickup van side, and not so much yet on the Class 8 over-the-road truck. But I'm sure it's coming. I'm sure it's coming.
Absolutely. If there's something cool out there, eventually someone's going to do it.
Heck yeah, you can count on that. That's the American way, my friend.
Absolutely. Well, Bryan, we're running out of time here, but I want to thank you again for all the information, and maybe we gave someone some cool ideas for lighting their truck. So be careful out there, and good talking with you.
All right. Until next time, y'all be good. Hey,
hey, fire it up. If you have questions for Bryan Martin, you can email them to bossmanonlandlinenow@chromeshopmafia.com. I'm Mark Reddick, and this is Landline Now.
Capital Reman, your leader in remanufactured diesel engines and components, is celebrating its 10th anniversary. Let us help you avoid costly downtime and repairs by visiting CapitalReman.com today. Use code OOIDA10 to receive your member benefits.
Get the most power performance out of your rig with Howe's Diesel Defender. It provides maximum lubricity and contains specialized IDX4 detergent to clean and prevent deposits and safely removes harmful water. Visit Howe'sProducts.com for more information.
Attention professional drivers, do you owe money to the IRS? Integrity Tax Relief Group frees drivers from IRS trouble. Call for help now, 855-976-4291. That's 855-976-4291.
Since you started, what you've loved about trucking is the freedom. Heading out on your favorite route, a good driving song, and thinking about truck insurance. Well, maybe not that last one. That's why we're here. At OOIDA, we have a full range of truck insurance products, expert advice, and great customer service, helping you get the right coverage for your operation. Go to OOIDA.com, because your job is to drive. Our job is to help with everything else.
Landline Now, welcome back. Every year, the Commercial Vehicle Safety Alliance conducts its annual Roadcheck Safety Blitz, with inspectors on the state and federal level going out across the country conducting Level 1 inspections on commercial motor vehicles. This year, the event takes place Tuesday, May 14th through Thursday, May 16th. And that means truckers have just a short time to get ready for what they may encounter that week. So what do you need to do in order to prepare? Here was some advice from Aaron Lynch and Tom Crowley of OOIDA's Compliance Department. Guys, thanks for joining me.
Thank you for having us, Mark.
Always good to be here, Mark.
Let's kind of start with an overview here. Can you walk us through what are the basic things that are involved in a Level 1 inspection?
Well, basically, a Level 1 inspection is your North America full inspection. You know, that covers your vehicle, you know, brakes, measurements, drums, rotors, lights, you know, just everything that touches the ground from the rubber up, you know, the truck all the way up to the driver's seat, because it includes a driver inspection, paperwork, you know, hours of service. I mean, it encompasses your whole operation out there on the road. You know, there are several different levels, like a Level 3 is a driver only, Level 2 is a walk around, but you're going to look for Level 1 inspections are going to be happening real frequently during this time period.
I want to kind of go over some of the detail on this with you guys. And the first category, I kind of looked up some stuff on it, having not been through one myself.
They're fun.
Oh, yeah. I've heard that they and proctologists have a lot in common. But driver credentials, when they talk about driver credentials, what are some of the credentials you need to have ready to give to that inspector?
Well, first and foremost, they're going to want to see your driver's license or CDL. You know, and they're going to want to see your vehicle information as far and let me back up and say, and your medical certificate. In most cases, they are connected with your driver's license. But I know there are a few states out there that say you still need to carry them. So. And then they'll move on to your truck paperwork. You know, you pull out your permit book, and a lot of guys just pull out the permit book and hand it to the cop, you know, and they go through there and check to make sure you've got your cab card for your registration with your IRP plate, your insurance information. And you know, there could be different permits involved depending on the state that you're in, your bill of lading as far as the load you're carrying or if you're empty, and then, of course, you know, onto your logbook, whether it's ELD or paper logs.
Another category here that they check on, and I looked up a little bit on this, is driver habits. And they talk about things like seatbelt use, which is pretty obvious, loading and unloading procedures, safety procedures, and drug and alcohol use. And Tom, you said a moment ago that that's one that a lot of our people ask us about. Obviously, the first thing is don't, but they're going to be checking some documentation, I assume. What are they looking for when it comes to drug and alcohol use during Level 1?
Well, it's not so much documentation, but on the Level 1, the controlled substance and alcohol possession, that's what they're looking for, to see, you know, whether you have alcohol in the truck, because, you know, I mean, as you recall, you can't even have cough syrup that contains alcohol, you know, no alcohol at all. That's a total prohibition. So they're going to be looking for that. And of course, you know, they're looking for anything they can see, smell, you know, as far as drug and alcohol, controlled substance and alcohol possession. And it says, and while they're checking for the presence of alcohol or controlled substance, the inspectors will also observe the driver for signs of alcohol or controlled substance use or impairment. They'll examine the cab, the trailer for alcohol and controlled substances, and conduct a query in the drug and alcohol clearinghouse. That's something that's a lot of folks don't realize, but they do that roadside now to make sure that your drivers have been through the drug and alcohol clearinghouse and have been cleared.
So again, this is something you want to make sure that you're properly signed up for, that you've got your stuff all in order on that before you get to this road check week.
Absolutely. You don't want to be put out of service because you have failed to do a query in the drug and alcohol clearinghouse. You know, failed to query one of your drivers or yourself if you're a single owner operator.
Okay. You mentioned a moment ago logs and ELDs. And with the advent of ELDs, is how they handle this changed or how has it changed?
Well, I mean, if you have an ELD, as most drivers out there that are familiar with ELDs know, when DOT pulls you over, they will want you, most cases, they will want you to send them your previous logs. And that's through a Bluetooth or an email, you know, whatever, depending on your location, whatever the officer chooses, they want you to send them to him. And that way they can actually take a look at them and kind of delve into the last 7 days and make sure that you're legal and compliant.
Now, it used to be you had to have like backup documentation, receipts and all that to back up your logs. Is that still necessary?
It is. And they've actually got a rule of 16 pieces of documentation. Basically everything, all the documentation that you produce during the day, whether it's your bill of lading, fuel receipts, toll receipts, anything that you would produce through your normal day of business is what they can ask for. And if you have it, they'll want to see it. Now, a lot of drivers send this stuff back to the carrier on a regular basis, which I do recommend. But verification receipts, documentation is what they're looking for. And I've had people tell me that they climbed up in their truck looking for this documentation. You know, it can happen. It doesn't happen often, but, you know, in all my years out there, I never had a DOT cop want to get in my truck, but it does happen. I do talk to people that it does happen to.
Okay, and they can do that.
And they can.
Okay. We've got a little bit of time left here, and I did want to get a couple of things to make sure they're in. And one of them, as I've been told over and over, the number one problem in many years at Roadcheck is brakes out of adjustment. How do you check to make sure they're in adjustment?
Well, if you're going to check adjustment, unless you have one of these readily checkable adjustment systems that you can purchase and put on your brakes, then it requires two people. It requires somebody to press the brakes and release, and another person to measure the stroke of push rod stroke. Excuse me, to measure that stroke and make sure that you are within your limits. And just a good rule of thumb is when you're under your truck looking at your brakes, if you can see any more than about an eighth of an inch gap between your brake and your drum, you really need to measure them to make sure that you're in place. Because, you know, 20% of brakes, you know, on a regular tractor-trailer configuration, you've got 10 brakes. 20% is two brakes. If you've got two brakes out of adjustment, you could be placed out of service.
They have the system they call a six-pack that works with the automatic slack adjusters. And as I understand it, Tom, correct me if I'm wrong, Aaron, that you just basically firmly press that brake down all the way and back six times, and that should get the slack adjusters to put them in adjustment.
And that's something, you know, Mark, if you recall, we've done shows over that basic premise right there. Yeah, any time that you are coming in for an inspection, take your time. When they say, driver, pull around back, we're going to do an inspection. As you pull around back, just before you set those brakes, firmly depress your brakes six times, because that will cause the slack adjusters to take out, if your slack adjusters are operating correctly, to take out the excess slack in your brakes, and it may save you that out of service.
Okay. Now, of course, all your other mechanical systems, engine, exhaust, steering, tires, axles, all need to be in proper working order. And there's some other things as well that they check for, but in the minute or so left, I want to address the attitude that people should have when they approach an inspection. How should you approach it when an inspector stops you at the side of the road?
Well, you should just be respectful. They're doing their job just like you are. You know, there's no reason to get bent out of shape over it. You know, I know it's time consuming sometimes, but at the end of the day, they're just trying to do their job and they're, you know, trying to make the road safer. That's their, you know, that's their basic premise.
And I got to say, through all the inspections, the roadside inspections that I've been through when I was driving, a lot of them, my attitude reflected back. If I had a crappy attitude or was, you know, not real cordial, wasn't a real good inspection.
Okay. Well, guys, we've run out of time, but thank you very much for the information.
Good to be here, man.
Thanks.
That's our program for today. I'm Mark Reddick, and this is Landline Now.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to like and subscribe. If you want more content, go to landline.media to get updated news, information, and archived editions of our show. Once again, that's landline.media.
I'm a dad.
A son.
A husband.
Wife.
I'm a writer.
Photographer.
I farm.
I'm a veteran.
I love old cars.
Fishing.
My kids.
Chrome.
And I am
a professional truck driver.
And together we are OOIDA.
OOIDA was founded by truckers to stand up and speak on behalf of truckers. We've done that by combining the individual voices of our members into a single, powerful voice. Protecting your interests, defending your rights.
Join us!
Make your voice heard. Join OOIDA, the Owner-Operator Independent Drivers Association. Call 1-800-444-5791 or visit OOIDA.com.